This video is about how did God speak through the prophets. Hi, I'm Bay Godofy, and this is Bible Study Verse by Verse. If you'd open your Bible to Hebrews chapter 1, we'll begin in just a moment. Hebrews chapter 1, verse 1, God, who at sundry times and diverse manners spoke in times past to the fathers by the prophets. God reveals himself. This is an amazing idea. He spoke in times past to the fathers, that's the Jewish fathers of their religion, by prophets, by people who were moved to speak God's word and communicated with God and then told it to other people. Now, God started talking to people right at the beginning of creation. He was talking to Adam when he created everything, and Adam was naming the animals, and God was talking to him. It was in the cool of the day, he and Eve would talk with God. God would come there and talk to them. And then Cain and Abel talked to God. In Genesis 4, verses 5 through 7, it says, "But to Cain and to his offering, he, God, had not respect. And Cain was very angry, and his countenance fell." In other words, you could see it on his face. "And the Lord said to Cain," here's God talking to him, "why are you angry? And why is your countenance fallen? If you do well, shall you not be accepted? And if you do not well, sin lies at the door." So God is a communicating God. From the very creation of the world, his modus operandi is to communicate with people. He talks to people. He communicates with people. Imagine this, the God who created everything. If you look up in the stars and in the heavens at night, if you can see them, without an overcast from a city, it's just an immense creation. If you look at the complexity of the human body and the creation of the earth and all the things that transpire as we revolve around the sun, it's an amazing creation. Imagine that God talks to us, to human beings. He wants to be known. He wants to communicate himself. He wants to reveal his will and how we're supposed to live, and how we're not supposed to sin, and how we're supposed to be saved. God is the author of revelation about himself. He didn't just create everything and wind it up and step back and let it go and hope for the best. He talks. He's involved. He's not distant and far off. His speech toward mankind is not an isolated incident. It happens all the time that God communicates with us. Where would we be if God did not communicate to us? We would not know him. For example, you can know about the creation of the world. You can see what God has done. And Romans chapter 1 tells us it's enough to make us guilty and without excuse. We can see it in our bodies. We can see it in the creation around us. Romans 1, 19 and 20. "Because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God has shown it to them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they," people, human beings, mankind, "are without excuse." So by the creation, we have no excuse. There's going to be no one that can stand before God and say, "I got an excuse. Here's my excuse. It's not going to fly." Because there is no excuse before God. All the world's going to be guilty before God because of the creation. But it's not enough to save us. We need the direct communication from God about the Lord Jesus Christ and about his sacrificial atonement for us. We have to have words spoken by God that will save us. Here's what God requires in Deuteronomy 6, verses 1 and 2, and then verse 4 and 6. It says there, "Now these are the commandments and the statutes and the judgments which your Lord God commanded to teach you, that you might do them in the land where you go to possess it, that you might fear the Lord your God, to keep all his statutes and his commandments which I command you." Do you hear God speaking here? God says, "I'm giving you this land, and I want you to do all these things. Keep my statutes. Keep my commandments. Listen to what I say." Verse 4 of Deuteronomy chapter 6. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. And you shall love the Lord God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your might. And these words which I command you this day shall be in your heart. That's God communicating to mankind. We have responsibilities based on that communication. He talks to us. He reveals himself to us. Who he is. It's not just that we're guilty because of the creation. We're guilty because he's talked to us and told us exactly how we're supposed to live and what we're supposed to do. All we know about God comes to us as a revelation from him. And we'd be lost without that, without his revelation. Never take the Bible for granted. Here's what it says. Sundry times, diverse manners. Sundry means many portions, piecemeal. Diverse manners means in different forms. In other words, there's a large variety of ways that God communicates with men, and we see it in the Old Testament. There's voices and dreams and visions. Listen to Numbers chapter 12, verses 6 through 8. And he said, "Hear now my words. If there is a prophet among you," so a prophet is somebody who speaks for God, "I, the Lord, will make myself known to him in a vision, and I will speak to him in a dream. And my servant Moses is not so, who is faithful in all my house. With him I will speak mouth to mouth or directly." So there's different ways that God communicates, visions and dreams, but there's some people that he talks mouth to mouth with. Direct communication from God, inspired, immediate revelation. Now there's the Urim and the Thurim in Exodus 28, verse 30. It's too complicated. We won't go back there and look at it, but it's casting lots. There's signs. There's fiery bushes. There's fiery clouds. There's fiery mountains. There's riddles. There's dark sayings. There's Levitical ceremonies. All these are ways that God communicated. Piecemeal, over time, different ways, through different people. In 1 Kings chapter 19, verse 9, and then 11 and 13 and 15 and 16. Here's a communication from God to Elijah. And Elijah is fleeing from Jezebel. He is fleeing for his life. He's afraid for his life. She's after him. She's going to kill him. And he came to a cave there and lodged there. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him and said to him, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" And then God said, "Go forth and stand upon the mountain before the Lord." And behold, the Lord passed by. And a great strong wind tore the mountain and broke in pieces the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, you know this, a still small voice. And it was so when Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his mantle, wrapped himself up, and he went out, and he stood at the entering end of the cave. And behold, there came a voice to him. Here's speech from God to his prophet. Here it is. And he said, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" And the Lord said to him in verse 15, "Go your way to the wilderness of Damascus, and when you've come, anoint Hazael to be king over Syria. And Jehu shall you anoint to be king over Israel. And Elisha shall you anoint to be prophet in your place." Here's his instructions from God from a still small voice. Go anoint these two people to be kings. Go anoint your successor, the prophet that's going to follow after you. This is just amazing. God talks to people. God's been talking to people since the creation of the world. We have his written word that you can hold in your lap in the Bible, that you can understand his will for us. This is just exciting and amazing. It's a progressive revelation to the fathers by the prophets. God reveals himself with gradual doctrine in the Old Testament. And information builds upon one another. Communication starts immediately at creation, but Moses received the word of God and began to write things down. He wrote the first five books of the Old Testament. Now, How did Moses know about the creation and what happened from the time of the creation up until the time that he was alive? This is a revelation from God. Do you see that? God showed it to him. He wrote as he was moved by the Holy Spirit of God about the creation of the world and the first five books of the Old Testament. From the book of Genesis to the book of Malachi, the period of that time of writing was about from 1400 BC to 400 BC. So it's a period of about 1,000 years. The Old Testament, of course, God was speaking from creation all the way up into the time of Moses, and after that, God was still speaking, but the writing, the actual writing of the Old Testament took about 1,000 years to write, from Genesis to Malachi. He communicated to the fathers by the prophets, by the patriarchs. Abraham was a prophet. Isaac was a prophet. Jacob was a prophet. Joseph was a prophet. Moses was a prophet. These people spoke to their nation. And there were multiple prophets who spoke for God. 2 Peter 1, verse 20 and 21 says, "Knowing this first, that no prophecy of Scripture is of any private interpretation." Okay, why? How can that be? You can't just say what it means just for you. Okay, it's for the whole church, for everybody. "For the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man." Do you understand that? Prophecy isn't by man's will. It's from God. "But holy men of God spoke as they were moved by the Holy Ghost." That's how prophecy happened. God moved people to write. He moved and he used them. He used their personalities. He used their intelligence. But he was the author of the Scripture. Men spoke as they were moved by God. The Jews had the oracles of God. This is what set them apart in Romans 3, verses 1 and 2. What advantage does the Jew have? Or what profit is there in circumcision? That is, circumcision stands for being a Jew. What profit is there in their religion? Much in every way, chiefly because to them was committed the oracles of God. God dealt with them. God spoke to them. He spoke through the prophets to the fathers. That's the way God communicated in the Old Testament. Let me give you an example of Samuel. Samuel's a little boy. He's been given by his mother to the high priest, Eli. So Hannah dedicated him to the Lord. In the Old Testament, the firstborn male was to be given to the Lord, and you could redeem them by sacrificing something and keep your son, or you could give him to the Lord. So she gave him, she promised him to the Lord. So he was weaned, he was given to Eli, and God's starting to talk to this little guy. And he's talking to him and he's calling to him at night. And 1 Samuel 3:8, "And the Lord called Samuel again a third time. And he rose and he went to Eli and he said, 'Here I am, for you called me.' And Eli perceived that the Lord had called the child." And that's the call of God upon this person's life. God's talking to him at a young age. And then 1 Samuel 12:18, "So Samuel called to the Lord, and the Lord sent thunder and rain that day. And all the people greatly feared the Lord, and they feared Samuel." Here's a person that is moved by God and spokesman for God, speaking to God directly to him, hearing from him, telling God's word to the people. In 1 Samuel 16:1 and then verse 7, "The Lord said to Samuel, 'How long will you mourn for Saul, seeing I've rejected him from being king over Israel?'" So he's a king anointer from God, Samuel is. "Fill your horn with oil and go, and I will send you to Jesse the Bethlehemite, for I have provided for myself a king among his sons. But the Lord said to Samuel, 'Do not look on his countenance.'" In other words, it's not, I'm not looking on that person's physical stature or his beauty or anything about those boys that I'm going to pick one of them to be the king, or the height of his stature, "because I have refused him. For the Lord sees not as man sees. For man looks on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart." So This guy is an anointer of kings. God is directing him. He speaks for God. People fear the Lord, and they fear Samuel because he speaks directly for God. And then in 2 Samuel 12, verse 1 and then verse 9 through 14 is another example. This is the prophet Nathan talking to David. David has stayed behind when his troops went out to war, and he's seen a woman, and he lusted after her, and he called her, and he's committed adultery with her, conceived a child. He's brought her husband home from the war, tried to get him to go into his wife. He wouldn't do it. He sent him back with his own death warrant, put this guy out in the front of the battle, and then withdraw from him and have him killed. So he's committed adultery. He's committed murder. God is not happy with this. And he talks to Nathan and tells him to go to David. David is not repenting of his sin. David is sweeping it under the carpet, as it were. And God is going to forgive his sin, but the consequences are going to filter down into his life for the rest of his life and in his children and for a long time thereafter. So verse 10 of 2 Samuel chapter 12, Therefore the sword shall not depart from your house, because you've despised me and have taken the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be your wife. Thus says the Lord, behold, I will raise up evil against you out of your own house. And who's putting evil against David? The Lord is. Out of his own house. I will take your wives before your eyes and give them to your neighbor. And that happened. His son went into his wives on top of his roof in a tent. And I will do this thing before, you did it secretly, but I will do this thing before Israel, before the sun. And David said to Nathan, I've sinned against the Lord. And Nathan said to David, the Lord has put away your sin. You shall not die. Nevertheless, now that's a bad word when you're talking about sin. That sin is going to come down on your life. Because of by this deed, you've given great occasion to the enemies of the Lord to blaspheme. The child also that is born to you shall surely die. Death to the child. The sword won't depart from David. His sons are going to be against him. Absalom is claiming to be the king and taking David's wives and having relationships with him before the nation. I mean, we can expect that when we repent of our sins, God will forgive us, but the consequences may still be there in our lives. Things like this may happen to us. The Old Testament revelation from God took thousands of years, and it took 1,000 years to write it all down. In sundry times and in diverse manners, God spoke. God has been talking to and with man since the beginning. He reveals himself. He didn't just wind up the world and set it on its course and then step back and let it go its way. He's intimately involved and talking, and there's a progressive revelation of himself within the scripture and to mankind. Thanks for watching. I hope the Lord saves you as you commit yourself in faith to the Lord Jesus Christ. I have hundreds of Bible teaching videos on my YouTube channel. You can click the red circle icon below to go there. Then you can click on the playlist and select the videos you'd like to watch. If you have questions or comments about this video, you can email me at all one word, BibleStudyVV@gmail.com. And please don't forget to subscribe to my channel for more Bible study, verse by verse.